with over 18 years of experience.
What I love about interviews is finding out what the person is trying to not tell me, reading between the lines.
Tamanna Inamdar is objective.
I believe in bringing every side of the story to viewers and leaving it to their intelligence to come to their own conclusions.
She is unbiased. Catch Tamanna Inamdar on India Development Debate all through the week at 9 p.m. only on ET Now.
Everyone, a very good morning. You've tuned into Market Fatafat on ET Now with me, Mubina Kapasi. It's the day of red on the screen for the markets. 350 point drop for the Sensex and the Nifty, almost 100 points of loss seen on that benchmark. Market Fatafat is of course flagging off those individual movers and shakers, but before we do that, here is an update when it comes to the Carvi case. There is a possibility of a relief for all Carvi clients. The SAT has now taken up Carvi's appeal on the SEBI order. We have Rahul Kumar joining us now on the phone line. Rahul, take us through the details.
Well, Securities Appellate Tribunal has directed SEBI to act upon case via request of limited uses of power of attorney by Monday. Now, SAT has said that you have to act upon case via request by Monday. And then what was there were two directions issued by SEBI in Carvi matter. The first one was he cannot onboard any new client. And the second one was you're restraining him from using power of attorney as far as his client Securities is concerned. Now, KSBL is opposing against and it wants an interim relief on that because it is saying that it is affecting their day-to-day business and retail investors are unable to settle their trade because of that. Now, SEBI has been pretty clear that the power of attorney can only be used if you will take physical permission from their client. So, KSBL was saying that in the court that this is not possible because they have 25,000 trades going daily on and 20,000 trades are on. So it is practically impossible for them to go to every investor and take their physical verification while using power of attorney. Now, SAT has directed SEBI to act upon its request and it can happen that on Monday SEBI can pass an order and can waive off that clause. But it also made it clear that this is not a small case and the entire misuse of power of attorney is much more than what was apprehended in the forensic audit. So it is bigger than that. So it can also happen that SEBI cannot act upon this and it can pass an order not in the favor of KSBS. So we'll have to wait and watch till Monday that what order SEBI passes.
All right. Thanks a lot, Rahul, for that. So, yes, it's still early days, obviously. I mean, the order is yet to be passed. It's possible that there will be a bit of a reprieve for Carvi's clients. Okay, meantime, the other big news that we are watching out for is the GDP data for the October quarter. Varun Hirimath is standing by with a lowdown on what the street is expecting of the big macro data. And Varun, after 5% in the previous quarter, now the expectation is it'll go even below 5%.
So it looks like another slow quarter that we're being faced with over here. It would be the sixth quarter in a row now that GDP estimates are declining and the real GDP is declining as well. Now we've got to look at the causes for this and the factors that are influencing the same. Firstly, the rate is likely to be 4.3 versus 5% QOQ. So that's not a mild contraction. You're looking at quite a serious dip over there. Now, there's a couple of reasons for this. Obviously, the contraction in consumption being one, weak investments being the second primary reason for the same. and then underperforming service sector. Now, this is not the only trigger for a downward spiral here, but they were usually uplifters of the GDP and they aren't performing that well in recent times. Now, you have to look at the quarterly trajectory over here. So over four sequential quarters, you're looking at the growth slowly taper off now to even coming below 5%. At one time, my economy, as you can see, used to grow at 7 and 8%. So that's also a huge raised red flag over here. Now, the pillars of our economy, agriculture being one of them, this has seen a large slowdown, 1.3% versus 5%. We had a delayed monsoon this year. There was a delayed sowing of crops in Kharif, which later delayed planting, so that's not done too well. Now, industry growth is also really low at 1% versus 9%. We've seen that, you know, corporates don't have any incentive to do capex. There's a liquidity crunch. The NBFC problem doesn't really help the situation either. And services sector, which are the backbone of our exports, things like IT, are also seeing a slowdown.
All right, Varun, thanks a lot for that. So that's, of course, what the ET Now poll is suggesting when it comes to the October numbers. Stay tuned to ET Now. 5:30 p.m. is when the number will be released. Okay, meantime, on the topic of GDP, here's Arvind Virmani talking about what the economy could do in the October quarter and what are the moving factors for the economy.
Many thanks for joining us at ET Now, sir. Sir, firstly, as we are aware that we are all waiting for the GDP data for until September, and in the first quarter it did not fare very well. It was only at about 5%. This time, a lot of people are saying it might not even cross 4%. What is your expectation with respect to that?
So my forecast is that it will be between 4 and 4.5%. We have a range of forecasts which have formally come out. They are basically between, on record, I mean, 4.2 and 4.5. But I would say anything is possible down to 4%, so between 4 and 4.5%.
So why? What do you think is the reason behind it, and what can the government do now to pump prime the economy?
So there are many multiple reasons, but to simplify it a little bit, and that has been you know, something I've been saying in many different interviews for the last 3 months. Basically, there is one, of course, is the one which everybody kind of has noted, this whole issue of excessively tight monetary policy. But that's not a new thing. Actually, the monetary policy has been tight since roughly 2011 or so. But it's had a gradual effect in lowering the credit ratio. So monetary policy clearly needs to be loosened. There are some small signs that is beginning to happen. I hope it is taken much further. For example, by reducing the repo rate to zero, by focusing on the monetary base, which kind of the new approach, I would call it an ideological approach, which emanated from New York and Chicago, has not focused on. So that is one aspect. The fiscal aspect where government has started, so that is one. The second channel has been that somehow our policies have not been balanced between what I call the carrot and the stick. You know, we have focused too much on kind of beating the black economy and not enough on incentivizing the white economy. So that relative balance got disturbed till this budget. But after that, we have finally, I think the government has realized that this has happened and is taking steps. So what was the balance? Balance is very clear. I mean, since 2014, actually, the pressures came from before. You'll recall the anti-corruption agitation, SC getting involved, and so on. I think the focus of too many people, because the public pressure was much more on reducing the black economy, and the automatic assumption that people will move, if they have this huge stick on the black economy, they'll move to the white. Unfortunately, that has not happened, because as I said, there's not enough incentive being provided on the other side. So it's actually depressed the black economy and kind of taken the whole economy down with it. So those policies have to be reversed and more done on the white side, among which is the points I've been making, the GST reform, the direct tax code, and so on.
Right. Sir, quickly, lastly, I want your comment on the consumer expenditure, the consumer spending falling for the first time in the last four decades.
I've looked at the data carefully. There is no fall in the private consumption expenditures. I think this is like a mantra. What I do see when I look closely at the decline in rate of growth, that that role of, let's say, consumer non-durables is somewhat larger than we've seen before, which is why there's because the GDP data is not detailed. So if you match that with the IIP data, then I think what is true is that the two sector of garments and textiles and processed foods, remember this is IIP, so this is all formal sector, not the informal now, I'm not talking about informal, this is IIP, because GDP data is not there in that detail quarterly. So certainly there is some impact on that, but I don't agree with the analysis that it's all due, it's due to decline in rural wages and things like that. Actually, I've looked very carefully at the rural wage data, and actually real wages have been increasing for the last, I would say, roughly 18, I don't remember the exact months, but at roughly 0.7% per annum. So that and this compares with the earlier period. There was a little period where they bumped up for a couple of years, but if you go back to before that, for a period of something like 7 years before, they were only growing at at an average of 0.2%. So if we put it in a historical perspective, 0.7% is not so bad. I mean, obviously it's not great. So it's really what I said about this relative balance between black and white economy and this clogging of channels, which certainly that's what I link it to, the NBFC crisis, etc. Unfortunately, I'm not able to get loan data on NBFCs, but the, if I go by, well, ET report, which shows that there's been a decline of 30% or so, that would explain. You know, if 30% credit goes down to the household sector, it'll affect everything. It'll affect their consumption, investment, savings, everything.
All right. Many thanks for joining us, sir. Thank you.
All right. That, of course, was the big exclusive with Arvind Virmani, citing even some data read in ET. Okay, let's take a look at the RWI small case very quickly and see if that one too is seeing a bout of red on the screen, because the Nifty and the Sensex certainly have cracked quite a bit after seeing a nice up move come by. Well, yes, it's 0.6% down, just bang at that 564 level. We'll do one thing, we'll take a very short break, but when we return, we'll kickstart the countdown on Market Fatafat.
In association with Tata Capital, count on us.
Stock markets is a numbers game, and it sometimes does come across as one-dimensional. But what people don't see is that these numbers, when strung together, tell a story. There's no really black or white. It very much seems to be a work in progress of triumphs and mistakes, greed and fear. And I bring you that story behind the numbers in action.
ये क्या? एक हफ्ते की ट्रिप के लिए पूरी अलमारी पैक कर ली?
एक नहीं, तीन हफ्ते यूरोप में.
और पैसे?
मैनेज हो गए.
ठीक है भाई, करो खर्चा.
मॉम, खर्चा तो मैं किश्तों में चुका दूंगी, पर लाइफ थोड़ी किश्तों में जीऊंगी.
पिछले 100 सालों से ऐसी हर अच्छी शुरुआत का साथ दे रहे हैं हम, यूनियन बैंक ऑफ इंडिया.
This is Vicky calling. Term plan kab loge, darling?
ये खर्चा एक टेंशन है, मेरे फायदे का नो मेंशन है.
ये पॉलिसी एकदम न्यू है ब्रो, मंथली इनकम फॉर यू है, यानी जियो तो पैसा अपना साथी, सेफ फैमिली का सपना.
ईगो लाइफ का नया आइटम इंश्योरेंस प्लान, अब प्रोटेक्शन के साथ मंथली इनकम.
नो टेंशन.
आपके सभी ट्रेड कंफर्मेशन रिपोर्ट्स पाने के लिए अपने सभी रजिस्टर्ड ब्रोकर को दिए हुए केवाईसी फॉर्म में एड्रेस, मोबाइल नंबर और ईमेल आईडी को हमेशा अपडेटेड रखें. एनएससी, एक कदम सही 100 गुना सुरक्षा.
सोच कर, समझ कर, इन्वेस्ट कर।
एनएसई द्वारा निवेशकों के हित में जारी।
Serendipity Arts Festival, India's biggest multidisciplinary arts festival, is back in Goa for its fourth edition.
The very meaning of serendipity is a happy coincidence. The idea was to see if we can bring back some of the interdisciplinarity and expose lots and lots of young people to the art.
With over 1,000 artists creating over 100 compelling projects, the festival is a week-long art extravaganza.
How do you create public spaces that engage with the arts and the people? And that's really been how we've planned Serendipity Arts Festival.
Join us this weekend as we explore the avenue that has brought together some of the most eminent artists only on ET Now.
कब लोगे डार्लिंग?
ये खर्चा एक टेंशन है, मेरे फायदे का नो मेंशन है।
ये पॉलिसी एकदम न्यू है ब्रो, मंथली इनकम फॉर यू है,
यानी जियो तो पैसा अपना साथ ही सेव फैमिली का सपना।
ईगल लाइफ का नया आइटम इंश्योरेंस प्लान, अब प्रोटेक्शन के साथ मंथली इनकम।
नो टेंशन।
Welcome back. You're watching Market Fatafat on ET Now. Let's now finally kickstart our countdown. First up, I would like to introduce our technical expert for the day. We are joined today by Nirav Chheda of Nirmal Bank Securities, and we also have with us from our research team, Pranay and Vivek. Morning, everyone, and let's kickstart the show with a stock that continues to gain in double digits, and that's India Bulls Housing Finance. A great uptick seen in this one. Though, mind you, today we are slightly off the day's high. Yesterday we saw a double-digit gain. Today in the earlier part of the day as well, I think the last time I checked, it was gaining 12%. Now it's ebbed off a tad bit. But nevertheless, third straight day of a rally. Do remember that we did have the receding risk on the court case. Yesterday we had some news with respect to how there were no wrongdoings as such that were found based on the PIL that was filed against the India Bulls Group. Now, CLSA has a buy here, target at 450 rupees, as they believe that the clarity can improve the company's access to the debt market, aid liquidity and growth. And the fact is that the current valuations after the massive crack we've seen in the India Bulls Group stock, particularly in housing finance, is very, very attractive. There is receding risk on court cases. The uptick in growth as well can drive re-rating. Okay, let's move on and talk about a Hero Motorcorp. Nirav, yesterday the auto stocks were big losers. Today as well, the declining trend continues, and of course all of this ahead of the November sales data. What's your view on the technical setup ahead of this data?
Yeah. See, Hero Motor had fallen from about 3,000 odd levels. It is now around 2,400 odd. I believe the risk reward here is favorable for going long. It is at, you know, a good support area of 2,400 odd. I don't think it is going to break 2,400 very soon. So, you know, here one can buy the stock with a stop loss of about 2,400. It is at 2,440 odd at this point of time. I believe it can go up again towards the 2,550 odd levels. You know, an inside candle has been made on the weekly, which is very positive for the next week.
That's a buy on a Hero Motorcorp, target 2550. Pranay, today we are also watching out for Yes Bank. What's on the agenda on the all-important board meet?
Well, the board meet is largely for the capital raising, and word on the street is that it should be able to secure funding in excess of $1 billion. What the street will be watching is the names of the investors who participate in this fundraising round, and given Ravneet Gill Ravneet Gill's access to all the marquee investors, not just from the banking circle, but also from fintech. Those names will be very important for the bank's liquidity, tier one ratios, and also the next leg of growth.
All right, that's then the view coming in on a Yes Bank. It's it was gaining earlier in trade, but now it's just about 2% down. And Vivek, we know what's been happening in telecom stocks, a great surge. The concomitant impact is seen in a Bharti Infratel as well.
Well, that's right. So, you know, clear proxy way as far as the entire telecom pack is concerned. There were worries about the viability of the third participant, that is Vodafone Idea, and which is why the stock saw derating. But given the fact that most of these names are most likely going to take price hikes, you know, the viability is now back in the system, and which is why Infratel has again re-rated from its previous low. The stock has done extremely well for itself, and last 3 to 4 trading sessions has done spectacularly. Definitely one to watch out for, and the quantum of the price hikes taken by telecom operators will definitely need to be tracked.
Well, yes, 8% higher today for a Bharti Infratel. Superb gain seen over here. Now, L&T Finance as well is a stock on our radar because this week it's raked in the gains. First, of course, we had that NBFC story, brokerage upgrade. Today as well, Goldman Sachs has initiated a buy on L&T Finance with the target at 140 rupees. They believe that there is emerging value for attractive profit pools, and the company is positioned to scale while providing comfort on profitability as well. Do remember that we had another foreign brokerage talk about how the management has always focused on growth opportunities, on how renewables financing is a new up-and-coming space in which L&T Finance is well-positioned. So that as well is something that could be a growth trigger, a re-rating trigger of sorts. L&T Finance continues on its upward trajectory. Okay, very quickly moving on. Nirav, today while the auto stocks are in the red, we had Tata Motors that was relatively a little more resilient, but now this one too has flattened out and it's given up the gains. What's your view here?
Yeah, see, the reason being, you know, Tata Motors from 110, 120 odd levels has moved up to about 180 odd. Now this consolidation is going on. So I believe, you know, you should not be buying at least Tata Motors for this point of time, because it hasn't really fallen. It hasn't really gone up in the last 3-4 weeks. I think this consolidation will go on for further, you know, 2-3 weeks. Until and unless it breaks above the 175 odd levels, you know, there should be no trade initiated for Tata Motors at this point of time. A good support area for this stock is around 150 odd, and if it comes there, that is when, you know, look to add or on a breakout of 175.
Okay, that's Tata Motors for you at 164 rupees. Now let's move on and talk about a sector that's really had all the attention this week, and that's the steel stocks. The US-China trade war bit finally playing out with some positive news flow. Pranay, what's the latest here?
Well, the reason why steel stocks are a little soft today is because of, you know, President Trump signing a bill into a law which basically favors the protesters in Hong Kong, and that hasn't gone down well with China. So they have said that they will take countermeasures to such an action from US, and that is at a time when they are trying hard for you know, this trade deal. That's why the steel stocks are down, because of doubts over how delayed the deal could get. But for the local steel mills over here, they are poised to take a second price hike in December, which could be to the tune of about 500 to 1000 rupees per ton. This will be both for flat and rolled steel products. It's the second straight price hike which will come in after the one that we had seen in November, and this will be a similar one, so that should be positive for the prices going forward.
All right, Steel Authority of India, Tata Steel are down, but JSW Steel is really managing to stay higher in trade. By the way, we had a brokerage note as well that spoke about these price hikes. Indian Bank, meantime, Vivek, today PSU banks are taking it a bit easy, but this one is standing out.
Well, absolutely right. Remember, this is the only bank amongst the PSU banking space that even earlier had said that they aren't really looking at raising further capital. They, in fact, told the RBI that they weren't looking at any capital infusion. This particular bank, you know, asset quality continues to remain quite good, and which is why if you're looking at the stock today, surging in trade, and it's again one of those candidates that could re-rate on the back of multiple worries that are getting sorted one by one in the NCLT scenario.
Very quickly, Nirav, I want to take a quick word from you on an Equitas, because again, these SMB stocks continue to rise.
Yeah, see, from the metal pack, I believe, you know, a lot of stocks are actually attractive with Tata Steel, JSW Steel being the two. The open interest for both these stocks is quite low, and I don't think, you know, a big fall is going to come in the either of the two. Tata Steel is down today, yes, but I believe it can come towards the 420, 415 odd levels and, you know, then move up from there. For JSW Steel, a huge breakout has come in, a trendline breakout at that, and I believe, you know, it is here to stay. It is above 258 levels as well. After a long time, you know, the trend has become positive for JSW Steel. So definitely it is a buy for me, you know, buy on dips 258 and 256. These are the two levels which are very important for JSW Steel on the downside, and it is saving both of them. So it is going to get support from here, and, you know, it is likely to move up towards the 280 to 290 odd level. So I believe one should be buying JSW Steel at these levels.
It's a buy on JSW Steel. But with that, we're out of time, so we'll have to wrap it up on Market Fatafat. Neera, Vivek and Pranay, thank you for joining in. Stay tuned. Markets at Noon comes up next.
ये क्या एक हफ्ते की ट्रिप के लिए पूरी अलमारी पैक कर ली
एक नहीं तीन हफ्ते यूरोप में
और पैसे
मैनेज हो गए
ठीक है भाई करो खर्चा
खर्चा तो मैं किश्तों में चुका दूंगी पर लाइफ थोड़ी किश्तों में जीऊंगी
पिछले 100 सालों से ऐसी हर अच्छी शुरुआत का साथ दे रहे हैं हम यूनियन बैंक ऑफ इंडिया
दिस इज विक्की कॉलिंग टर्म प्लान कब लोगे डार्लिंग
ये खर्चा एक टेंशन है मेरे फायदे का नो मेंशन है
ये पॉलिसी एकदम न्यू है ब्रो मंथली इनकम फॉर यू है
यानी जियो तो पैसा अपना साथी सेफ फैमिली का सपना
ईगो लाइफ का नया आइटम इंश्योरेंस प्लान अब प्रोटेक्शन के साथ मंथली इनकम
नो टेंशन
कम ऑन गाइस We're almost there. चलो एक टी ब्रेक लेते हैं
यहाँ कैसे
बस वाग बकरी इंस्टेंट टी में गर्म पानी मिलाओ और एक मिनट में घर जैसी चाय का मजा उठाओ सिंपल
एकदम घर जैसी
पैक किया क्या
We set the fire, you know it's going down.
To avail Movies Now, MNX, and Romedy Now at just 10 rupees, call your cable operator or DTH operator right now.
The Economic Times Awards for Corporate Excellence honor the vision, fortitude, and success of India's top business and political leaders. An evening of triumph and celebration to honor those who've raised the bar for excellence. Deloitte presents the Economic Times Awards for Corporate Excellence 2019. Live on 30th November, 6 p.m. onwards. Exclusively on ET Now.
यही वीडियो देख के शो वाले तुमको सिलेक्ट करेंगे
बढ़ते हौसलों के बढ़ने दो कदम
बहुत अच्छे
अभी अपलोड कर देता हूँ
स्मिता अरे भाई प्रिया का सिलेक्शन हो गया शो में
मुंबई जाना 10-15 दिन रहना मेरे पास तो बैंक अकाउंट भी नहीं
अभी कर देते हैं
उम्मीदों से आगे हमें बढ़ते जाना है में
बढ़ने और बढ़ाने में विश्वास रखता है उज्जीवन स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक बढ़ते लोगों का बढ़ता बैंक
This is Vicky calling term plan kab loge darling
ye kharcha ek tension hai mere fayde ka no mention hai
ye policy ekdam new hai bro monthly income for you hai
yani jiyo to paisa apna saathi safe family ka sapna
ego life ka naya item insurance plan ab protection ke sath monthly income click
no tension
Price Friday cheer missing on the streets. Stocks retreat from highs with Sensex and Nifty clocking a triple-digit fall. Banks, autos and metals crack under selling pressure.
Growth banks get worsened in Q2 GDP. Could slide around 4.2%, 4.3%. This could be one of the lowest growth that you could see in the series of 11-12, which was released earlier. Demand weakening, manufacturing is likely to be the key culprit.
Motown's festive joyride likely to come to a halt in November. Most car makers may clock double-digit growth compared to last year. Both passenger and commercial vehicles volume seen under pressure. Two-wheelers also may have a rough ride, given that the base was very high.
Yes, Bank. In focus today, board is likely to do the fundraising, or board is to meet for fundraising, and lenders have received $1 billion bid from global investors. Some of the domestic players could also be in focus. Let's see what the board approves.
Hans begins to identify Aditya's successor at HDFC Bank. Six-member search panel comprising KK Mistry, Sandeep Parekh and Sharmila Gopinath, among others.
Goldman Sachs has a bullish view as far as L&T Finance is concerned, taking the stock higher in the session. The global brokerage initiates coverage with a buy, finds profit pool extremely attractive.
SEBI challenges SEBI order in SAT. The market regulator has barred the brokerage from taking new clients. Case likely to be heard today.
Farm loan waiver at 80% drop quota for locals are some of the promises made by Uddhav Thackeray. The newly appointed Maharashtra CM vows concrete aid to stress farmers after reviewing existing schemes.
Now, this is Markets at Noon. I'm Karunya Rao with Pankaj Podar. Pankaj, it was a sweet November for the markets, but December series started on a weak note.
Right. One can say 125 points. That's quite a bit sharp cut, about 1% in terms of decline. Mid-cap index down about 0.2%. Small cap, as of now, is holding up to about 0.6%. But, if the large cap market does not recover, you can expect some amount of flows to even come in the small cap space. Let's just look at some of the losers that are going in. And I'm looking at the broader markets as well as the normal markets. So, JSPL down about 3%. That is something which, was going up one way earlier. Similar is the case with Whirlpool, currently around 2,000 odd rupees. Hindalco is down about 3-odd%. So that's another one which is down. And PNB Housing is down about 2-2.5-odd%. Jubilant Foodworks is down about 2%. HDFC AMC, it's had a stellar rally, but it's down around 2% right now. SIS India is down 2%. RBL, NALCO, Delta Corp, HPCL are some of the other losers. This is what you're broadly seeing in the markets at this point of time. In terms of gainers, Gayatri Projects 10% higher, 69 to 70 rupees. Future Retail up 7%. At a point of time, it was up 17%. Bharti Infratel up about 6-odd%. Equitas 5% higher. Indiabull Housing also looking well. There is likely to be a case announcement today as well. So we'll wait and watch for that update if it comes. IDFC First Bank 5% higher. 46, 47 rupees for that name. Magma FinCorp 5% higher. L&T Finance, we told you about the brokerage report from Goldman, which has initiated coverage. So 5% move for that name. ICICI Securities up around 4%. It was up yesterday as well. Eris had a block deal, and post that, that has also gone up in the last couple of days.
Right. Vivek is also standing by to outline some more stocks and news, especially L&T Finance, which is in the limelight on back of that Goldman initiation of coverage. Vivek, can you tell us what the highlights of this report are?
Well, absolutely. So L&T Finance Holding, it's been a stellar rally that this particular stock has seen. What is it that Goldman is liking as far as L&T Finance Holding is concerned? Remember, most of the NBFC rally was parked off on the ET Now exclusive news break that actually said that the government is looking at something similar to the TARP program that we had a couple of years ago. So on the back of that also, given the fact that Goldman is now seeing value with very good risk-reward ratios as far as L&T Finance Holding is concerned, is also something that is driving the rally. So what is it that you're looking as far as L&T Finance Holding is concerned? The first thing, valuation, that 1.1 times price to book FY21, and at 7.5 times price to earnings FY21, what they are seeing is they're seeing significant amount of value. What they're also seeing is that the company is very well positioned to attain a lot of scalability, and they also believe that the company is very well poised in terms of actually being able to garner capital. On the back of all of these reasons, they're saying a buy call as far as L&T Finance Holding is concerned, and the target is quite high. Goldman believes that the target is almost at 140 rupees a share.
Right, Vivek, thanks for that. Yes Bank will be in focus. Yes Bank is a stock that one can look at. It's considering the board is going to meet today to consider fundraising in November, on November 29th, that is today. Most likely the announcement should come in the afternoon. The stock is down around 1%. It was up earlier as well. This is an important fundraising. We spoke to the management earlier and they said that they have received a binding offer for $1 billion from a foreign investor. So what they do, it's very important because this has been the buzzword since the time Mr. Ramneet Gill has taken over. When do they raise a substantial capital? What do they do with that capital? And right now the market cap is 17,000 odd crores. They are looking in for $1 billion of funding. So about $2.3 billion of current capital, and then you look at about $1.2 billion in terms of fundraising.
All right, that's Yes Bank for you. In more stocks in focus, we have India Bulls Housing Finance as well, which is looking, at least in the starting of the day, was looking quite upbeat. We'll have to pull up the stock to see how it has reacted. Okay, it's still very, very cheery, up a good 7%. Why that is? Well, a host of developments have transpired. CLSA has also come out with a note following up with that. They've maintained a buy. Target has been raised significantly from 350 rupees now to 450 rupees. They believe that the clarity on court case can definitely improve the company's access to debt market, and also aiding liquidity and growth for the company from here on. Current valuations, they say, are very attractive. Receding risks on court cases, uptick in growth. These are some factors which can drive a re-rating for the stock, and hence they've given such a ambitious target price as well. 200 basis points higher loan growth can lend about 3% earnings upside is what CLSA is saying. This is for FY21, of course. Base case continues to assume marginal growth till FY21. And on back of that, we're looking at India Bulls looking very, very upbeat on trade. Keeping it with the banking and financial sector, HDFC Bank is scouting for CEO Aditya Puri's successor. A board of directors, in fact, has set up a search committee to find a successor to him, who is set to retire, Aditya Puri, who will be retiring in October 2020. The committee includes names in the likes of Sandeep Parekh, KK Mistry, Shyamala Gopinath and others. Aditya Puri will continue to act as an advisor to this six-member group. Neha Tyagi is here with more details.
That's right, the board of directors in a meeting constituted a six-member search committee to look for a successor to Aditya Puri. Remember, his term ends on 26 October 2020. The search committee comprises of Shyamala Gopinath, who's the chairperson of the bank, as well as a former RBI deputy governor, Sanjeev Sachar, MD Ranganath, Sandeep Parekh, Shrikant Nadamuni and KK Mistry also are part of this committee. We are told that Aditya Puri will act as an advisor to this particular committee. Now, Aditya Puri, who will turn 70 next year, has an experience of over 40 years in the banking industry, including abroad, experience abroad and in India. He has been the managing director of HDFC since 1994, making him the longest serving chief executive of a private Indian bank. We're also told that he's the most highly paid CEO of any Indian bank. So these are going to be some really large shoes to fill in. What we're told is that the committee over the course of the next few months will evaluate internal as well as external candidates. Like I said, Aditya Puri will act as the advisor to the committee. His term ends on 26th October 2020.
Thanks, Neha, for that. Another important data that the street would be eyeing out for would, of course, be the auto sales data. And Karunya, when we talk about auto sales, of course, it will be released on Sunday. Some of them may even come on Monday. But what is the street anticipating?
Pankaj, the street is anticipating. A good thing is that they're expecting the sentiment to pick up, because that's what the channel checks have also indicated. Yes, on a month-on-month basis, the growth will be slightly lower, because do remember, last month was Navratri, Dashera, then Diwali, all of it falling in the month of October. YOY also, the base is extremely high, because same time last year in the month of November was the festival of Diwali, Dhanteras, etc. So that's why the base is also year on year is not comparable. Overall sentiment is looking much, much better now compared to pre-festive season period. So that's the silver lining that we must focus on. As far as the numbers go, for Maruti, we're expecting close to 1.5 lakh units, which is not a big dip if you look at a month-on-month basis. If a festive month is when they've clocked in 1.53 lakh units, I think 1.5 is really not a bad figure. M&M Auto, we're expecting 40,000. For Tata Motors PV, we're expecting 10,500. Now, Tata Motors CV is likely to be under tremendous pressure. Overall, CV segment has not recovered at all. There's a lot of surplus still lying with transporters. The infra activity pickup is not as per expectations. There's been a monsoon and rainfall issue as well in certain areas, flooding in certain areas, etc. So CV continues to be weak. So Tata Motors CV, we're expecting a degrowth of 26% YOY. But without comparing it, also if we look at it, we're expecting somewhere around 25,000 units. For Ashok Leyland, we're expecting 9,500. For Eicher CV, 3,300 expected. Eicher Royal Enfield is likely to outperform this time around. The only company, according to our poll, which is likely to post a growth year on year, 69,000 expected from Royal Enfield. Other two-wheelers, we're expecting Bajaj to come in around 4 lakh units. For Hero Moto, 5.4 lakh units are expected. TVS, so we're expecting 2.8 lakh units. Now let's talk about tractors. M&M tractors likely to clock in nearly 23,000 units, which is definitely a bit of a compression. Even Escorts, after a stellar performance last month, we're expecting 7,300 units to be logged in. So tractor business, also like CV, Pankaj, is likely to be fairly muted. PV two-wheelers definitely witnessing some green shoots.
But as you're saying that, you know, YOY numbers may not be comparable, and even month-on-month because of this. So you have to look at the numbers on a standalone basis.
Absolutely. You have to look at the overall numbers and compare it with perhaps how the trend has been so far this year. Because pre-festive, it was extremely, extremely weak. Very dismal numbers even from market leaders like Maruti, etc. So now compared to that, it's definitely a pickup.
Right, and even the auto stocks are looking slightly weak, but you know, there has been a rally in the markets. Autos have also been decent.